Good morning everyone. Children, today we will discuss about the chapter, that is chapter 4, expansion of British rule in North India. So let us begin. Children, did you know that the British did not come with the intention to rule India? At first, the Europeans only came to establish trading relations but soon became the political rulers of India. This British expansion and consolidation of their power is an important part of Indian history. The East India Company first came to India to establish trading relations with India. They were merchants and traders, but they had the backing of the Crown and the Queen, and this made them very powerful group. And once they saw the tremendous economic opportunities in India, they decided they wished to rule the country, not just trade with it. Now, company rule in India was the rule or dominion of the British East India Company over parts of the Indian subcontinent. This is variously taken to have commenced in 1757 after the Battle of Plassey, which saw the company conquest of the proto-industrialized Mughal Bengal. Later, the company was granted the Diwani. I think you have gone through the previous modules based on these chapters. So, or the right to collect revenue in Bengal and Bihar in 1773. When the company established a capital in Calcutta, appointed its first Governor General, Warren Hastings, and became directly involved in governance. By 1818, with the defeat of Marathas, followed by the pensioning of the Peshwa and the annexation of his territories, British supremacy in India was complete. Now, children, the British expansion continued, and they moved on to establish control in the region of Mysore. They fought many wars with the various Nijams of the region till they had complete control of the Mysore constituency. Similarly, they also battled with various Maratha Peshwas and rulers to expand their kingdoms. The disharmony between the Maratha rulers played right into the hand of the British, making their job easier. From there, the power of the British grew steadily. Over the next few years, they conquered Sindh and Awadh. The final step in Britain's consolidation of power was the conquest of the state of Punjab. They fought two Anglo-Sikh wars. The Sikh troops lost both wars, and the conquest was completed in the year of 1849. And now almost the entire subcontinent of India was under the control of the British. So children, today we are going to discuss about the first Anglo-Sikh war. Before beginning with today's discussion, let's discuss about Maharaja Ranjit Singh of Punjab. Children, under Maharaja Ranjit Singh's rule, Punjab remained a formidable kingdom, capable of checking the British expansion in India. However, his death in 1839 spelled disaster for the Sikh kingdoms. A succession of short-lived Sikh rulers strained relations between the Sikh court, that is Darbar, and the Sikh army and the triarchy by some Sikh generals resulted in Punjab being annexed by the British. So, the first Anglo-Sikh war. After the death of Maharaja Ranjit Singh, his three sons ruled for short periods, one after the other. It is believed that they were killed in the intra-family power struggle. In 1843, 5 years old, Dalip Singh, the youngest son of Ranjit Singh from his youngest wife, Maharani Jindan Kaur, was crowned as the King of Punjab. Jindan Kaur became the regent in the absence of a powerful ruler. The Sikh army generals had become ambitious and were not willing to bow to the command of the regent. The prevailing chaos in Punjab provided the British an opportunity to try to extend their control over the Sikh kingdom. Fearing a British attack, the Sikh army crossed the Sutlej River and entered the British territory in December 1845. It is believed that Maharani Jindan Kaur felt threatened by the powerful Sikh army and she had planned this incursion to reduce the army power. Responding to the Sikh incursion, Governor General Lord Hardinge declared war on Punjab. So children, this is all about the first Anglo-Sikh war. Relation broke and the British marched to Firozpur with British, Rajput, Bengali and many more troops. The Sikhs crossed the Sutlej with Punjabi, Pashto and Kashmiri forces. When the forces met in Firozpur, a full-scale war broke out. Tej Singh, the commander of the Sikh army, positioned his men to hold until death. The battle was decided out by artillery. The British had more. They blew the bridge behind the Sikh and they marched and attacked. With Tej Singh now deserted and nowhere to go, the Sikh held a last stand and perished. The Sikh had all 5,000 men killed or wounded. The British won the battle but suffered a great casualty of 4,000 plus men injured and 2,000 plus killed. Children, that's all for today, children. Have a nice day. Thank you.